everyone.
Thank you.
Hello, welcome. So I thought today I'd start off with basically a little project share, the sort of thing you might do in your communities of practice or when you have your project management meetups with your colleagues. I wanted to share with you a project that went really, really well for me. It was something I worked on late last year, end of 2015, and it went really, really well. And it's something that's really, really like sparked my imagination to think about what it was that went so well about it. So I did a lot of thinking about this, and it's influenced a lot of the kickoff work that I've done since. So what I'm going to focus on today is talking about that first initial kickoff workshop. So it might cover some of the stuff that Kevin talked about in the inception stuff, but I'm going to give my perspective from a product manager and a service designer's angle about the things that we need as a team to make sure we're in a good place to get started. So the project I'm going to talk to you about is called Network Locum, that was the client. And we had a really, really small team, and I was working for a digital product studio in London called Us2 at the time. And we have a studio down there, and the client approached us to work with them. The client didn't have any mobile experience. They had a web platform, and that's all they had, and it was being hung together by sticking tape. They were a small startup, so you can imagine the amount of effort and work they had to put in to keep this thing going and moving forward with a skeleton team. But one of their investors, one of the people who they were talking to, one of their advisors, suggested that they move into having a mobile application because they're certainly missing a lot of traffic there, and recommended us to. So they also never had any agency experience. So for us, that was a challenge. We had a client who didn't have any people to support a mobile application once we built it. They needed something in an exceptionally short amount of time. We had 10 weeks to do this project. And we had to get them an MVP that was shippable and in the App Store in a place that was something that felt like it was of high quality and represented their brand and the work that Us2 did. So it's safe to say that I was quite nervous about this job. I wasn't sure whether we'd be able to do this. The odds were stacked against us in terms of the people we were working with, their experience, and the time we had available. But with some thought, we decided to take this project on. So I just want to tell you a little bit about Network Locum. You've probably never heard of them. Some of you may have done, if you follow the startup scene. But they're a very small startup who are interested in disrupting the agency locum GP space. And that space is where GP surgeries phone up agencies, ask them for locum GPs, who then go out to their pool of GPs and get them in to cover sessions that they can't fill with salaried GPs. They take a huge cut for this, and the founder of the company, Melissa, who worked in the NHS, wanted to do something about it, and also saw a money-making opportunity, so let's be honest about that. Network Locum, lazy way to describe it, is the Airbnb for doctors. You can find, book, and manage your jobs on there, and manage your freelance work. What they lacked is access to doctors who were on the move, and mobile was the channel that they needed the most. Their web platform was satisfactory, I would say. They would also agree with that. But they also found that their mobile web presence wasn't very satisfactory, and they were keen to build a native iOS application. And this would give them access to doctors who spent most of their time in consulting rooms working on NHS computers that had no access to external websites. They were locked down computers. So this meant during the day, doctors and locums could use this to book and manage their jobs and look where they were coming next. It was a fantastic project. We successfully got them a first version, which was had razor-sharp focus on the core user needs of being able to find, manage, and book jobs. We got it into the App Store in 10 weeks, and it had high-quality, tested code. We ran BDD as a process on testing. We had user testing and user research on weekly cycles, most of the projects. It looked great, and it was simple to understand and use, and most importantly, it solved that core need for users and for their business. We had an amazing team, there's no doubt about it. We became really good friends by the end of it. This is the team. There's my weird head at the top left. I have no idea what happened on that photograph, but it does look twice as big as I think it does. We were fantastic. We had a great team. We also had fantastic stakeholders who were super focused with us. But I've had that before on projects, where projects have still not gone very well. You know, we've been great friends and we've worked really well, but the odds have been stacked against us. Maybe there's outside circumstances that got in the way. We didn't really perform well as a team. We didn't get to that point of being highly effective. And we weren't always super happy with the project or the product we ended up with at the end. So I came to the conclusion after this project and running a few more kickoffs that actually the way we kicked off this project had a huge impact on our ability to be successful with it. So what I wanted to do is just share some of those things that we did and take you through the planning of it, show you some of the tools, hopefully you'll get some inspiration, and focus on the side of the project, which is about the products and the people. So I'm not going to talk too much about ways of working and stand-up and routines and things like that. I'm sure you as digital project managers know that stuff better than I do, and you probably know this stuff too. But hopefully it'll give you some inspiration. So for me, a perfect kickoff is something that really sets the background and the context. It identifies all the known information that's available to the team and to the stakeholders, and it sets expectations and boundaries within the group. One of the core factors of a great kickoff day for me is setting the foundations in place to form a really high-performing team, a highly effective team. Some of the experiences I've had with great delivery managers and great product project managers is the people who focus more on the team and what they do, and not so much on the nuts and bolts of the project management side of things, which comes secondary. Those projects have always really performed well, and we've always been really successful. I think to summarize that, a perfect kickoff is about starting points. It gives you all the things you need to be able to take that step forward and start to investigate what you need to be able to fulfill the outcomes of the project. It acknowledges appropriately the mission at hand and also the team assembled to complete that mission. So what are those starting points? Well, for me, I work in digital product and service design. I'm generally designing things that have a user need attached to them. Some of you may work in marketing, in e-commerce, et cetera. You'll still have user needs and you have different sort of business objectives to meet. For me, it's generally creating a utility-based application, something that solves a goal or a task or a need, is where most of my work has been. Working on big trading systems, working on applications like Network Locum. It's about understanding user needs and the goals and the tasks that users need to do to get there. So what are those starting points? What do those look like for me? Well, I started out being an interaction designer, as Brett highlighted earlier. And when I first started doing my job, it was because I really couldn't understand all the poor design in the world. I hated seeing my parents struggle with a TV remote or a video. And I just thought it was just down to poor designers. I thought the world was full of poor designers and they didn't do design properly. And I, as a young 19-year-old, was better than all these designers who've been working in their careers for a long time. Young naivety really was something that was knocked out of me when I started my first job, and I realized working on mobile phone products that actually it's the process and the way we work together that makes a big difference. So whilst I was focused solely on the desirability of a product and user needs, I started to find out and realize that feasibility was just as important. And that was a key moment in my career when I realized the collaboration between designers and developers was just as important as me creating a perfect design and handing that over to a developer. And that was where the success was not happening. Our projects, when we did that, were the projects that were poor. Documentation got in the way of good collaboration and communication. So getting this right and starting to lead projects where I had to plan and talk to developers was a great step for me. I really understood this. But the other part of this is obviously the viability of a product. So making sure we understood business objectives, making something that had value that would sustain itself. So the desirability, the feasibility, and the viability of the product, perhaps the holy trinity of good products and service design. But I think working with fantastic delivery managers and agile coaches and really getting to understand team, I've been really lucky in my last two positions at Us2 and also now at the Co-op, where I'm working with fantastic delivery managers who really get the idea and concept of team. And it dawned on me that this is, I think, missing from how we describe how to create products and services. And it's that achievability, the achievable nature of this, so understanding team and projects, which you guys will know really, really well. So this for me is what a perfect kickoff looks like, and this is what a perfect project structure looks like. It covers desirability, viability, feasibility, and also achievability. And I want to talk about that a little bit now. So just before I do, I want to tell you about the team, the people we worked with. So this is what we looked like. there's five of us who worked in the digital studio, us two, and then we had two product owners, and that was Michael and Melissa. They were the CEO and the CTO of the product. Melissa was super busy. She was the one who knew everything. She had all the decisions. She ran the company. Ended up deferring a lot of the decisions over to Michael. So we worked with two stakeholders on this, and they were really, truly fantastic in terms of the way they worked with us. But I want to tell you a little bit about our profile. So Alana was a team coach. She's someone who could do agile coaching, but actually her main role in her work was to be a product manager and product lead, but she had a lot of experience on the coaching and team dynamics side, which was super helpful on this project. I worked as the product lead, making sure we made all the right decisions to get the right sort of balance for the MVP. And we worked with three people from three separate disciplines. So we didn't have any overlap in terms of discipline, which meant we had to make sure communication was really good between these people. Tom, as our iOS developer, he was new to the project and new to the company at the time, so had a lot of work to do to make sure he was integrated. Simon was a young designer, so he had a good amount of experience to get moving, but he would need some help with the visual design, branding language, and things like that. And Paz, one of our seasoned interaction designers, who would do the user research, help with UX flows, and work with Simon and Tom to sketch out solutions to the problem when we defined our user stories. As I said, we were a great team, but why was that the case? Well, it was because we trusted each other, and we trusted each other from day one. We could tell when Thomas was struggling a little bit, he didn't know where his boundaries are, so we made sure we made that clear within the project that we helped Tom out to understand where his permission lies and how he acted as a new member of the team and to get him to feel like he could be more honest with us. Our skills matched the challenge and they overlapped, so I could take on some of Alana's work, Alana could take on some of my work, which meant that we helped each other out, we could swap over when we needed to. Simon and Paz could work together and they understood UI and UX. And Tom could take on interaction design challenges while he was coding with a little bit of guidance and support from Paz. And that really helped with the flow of this project. I think we also knew our gaps and our personal goals, so we made it very clear at the start what the things we wanted to achieve and learn from the project, which meant that we weren't just working towards the project goals and the project outcomes, but some of our personal goals and personal outcomes. So let's talk a little bit about the kickoff. How did it go? What was it like? Well, prior to the actual kickoff and the start of the project, it's safe to say we've never turned up to a project without any information. That's like turning up to a football or a netball game and not doing any training. That's not how it works. We'll know what's going to happen when we walk up to that job. But I've had many different experiences of this, and some of you will be working for agencies and design studios. Some of you might be working for businesses that have their own products and services. Well, this project was working for an agency, and I've done a lot of these kickoffs, a lot of these projects and planning, and there's two different ways we've approached these. One is to do a pitch, where we come up with a concept and a product, pitch that in, enter into a competition, it's a fantastic idea, look at this, hey, we're fantastic, look at how great we are. And then there's the other approach where we just take an approach of consulting with the client and putting a proposal together. And my experience has always been that this is a better approach than entering to pitches. So over time, we started to move away from doing pitches in a way where we were trying to solve a problem before we actually understood the solution. And that's what we did on Network Loken. We had to spend a lot of time planning the project. Alana did a lot of time working with the client to understand what they were looking for, to reinterpret what they were asking for, and for us to then take that forward into a bit of a project plan. So I'm just going to focus on this section for a minute and talk about our timelines. We didn't know enough about the project to be able to plan out our project, but we knew we had 10 weeks to complete it. We wanted to try and portion the amount of time that was relevant to the job at hand. So we had to make some assumptions at the start of the project. One, that we could do a discovery and immersion in 1 week and what we would do with information we didn't know. And also then take an approach where we could do development delivery in an iterative fashion. So we had to put some stakes in the ground that allowed us to do that. This is where we treated, you know, we go back to that idea of treating assumptions, treating information as assumptions. We wanted to make sure we got to that point where we prioritized everything we knew about the project in a way that meant we could tackle it appropriately in the time we had available. And that's when I think it really became clear about how important it is to do so when you're on such a short project. You have no time to mess around and take things that are not super important to that critical path of completion. During the immersion week, we planned our kickoff day on the second day, which meant we got the team some time to be able to spend some time with their application, with Network Locum's web product. It allowed them to do some homework that we set them, and we could come together the next day with ready to start the kickoff day. When we planned the job, we decided early on that we had to keep, obviously, time to a minimum. There was no airs and graces about our work. We didn't try and wow our client with fancy documentation and our beautiful keynote decks and our fantastic templates. We needed to be as quick as possible. So between myself and Alana, we spent time thinking about what's the core information we need to gather from this kickoff and how we're going to get there to do it. And we created working sheets, essentially canvases that we could use in the kickoff room, take down and take into our project room, and they became living, breathing documents that we kept throughout the whole project. And this made it a very efficient process and also helped people see that the information we captured here was something that wasn't concrete. It wasn't something that would take a lot of time to do. So getting into the kickoff day, we set some goals on this, and for me, the goals of the kickoff, the goals of understanding where we're at, is to get that shared understanding between everyone in the team of the problem space, of the business and user assumptions, things that we're trying to tackle and challenge. We needed to prioritize these assumptions so we can ensure we have focus on what's most valuable, and we want to share expectations of how we'll work together over the project and what to expect out of it. When we planned the project, we made sure we got people in the room to help us plan the project who were from the disciplines who would be on the project at the time. And I think that made a big difference to how we planned this, because normally we might do that as leads, as project leads or as project managers, and we may not get a chance to consult with the people on the project or even the disciplines on the project who can give information that would be really handy with the planning. So we did that, and we also made sure from day one that everyone who was going to be on the project was in the kickoff, even if it was someone who was going to take who'd have more work in the future. We wanted to make sure they were there. We started off with some nice icebreakers. I'm sure I don't need to talk to you about those. This was speed drawing, nice little exercise. Look at the other person, draw a face, draw a portrait, 20 seconds, move on quickly. Really broke down the atmosphere, especially with Melissa and Michael, who didn't know how to work with us. We wanted to make them feel like there was a sense of fun with the project, and they were allowed to relax and enjoy it. They didn't have to feel like they were talking to a different group of people, which is obviously important to making a team feel like it's a one-team experience. To understand the business and context, we thought about how to get this across, and we set Melissa some homework. We wanted to know as much as we can about her project, and we gave her the task of filling in a business model canvas, which she brought down as notes on a piece of paper. And we put that up on the wall, and the business model canvas worked really well in the kickoff to capture everything as we interrogated and as we asked questions. It was a place to put that information. I think canvases are a really good tool for kickoffs in general, as long as you see this information that's up here as assumptions. I have worked on projects in the past where we've used canvases, and they become the Bible, the gospel for the project. But it might be something you've just created in that workshop, in that moment. And we drive all our decision-making based on something like this. That's obviously not so great, but if you have that mindset of assumptions and learning and hypothesis and testing, you can make sure you take this information and prioritize it and work with your stakeholders to decide what's the most important to test all the information that's not so known. Once we've done that, once we've spent some time with Melissa, I think we gave her about 45 minutes to talk this through, we wanted to just double check the understanding in the room between ourselves and our stakeholders. So we created a tool that we adapted from a fantastic toolbox online from Hyper Island, which gives you lots and lots of team working exercises you might find useful for your practice, called Project Background. And this was basically understand whether people understood their the purpose that we think we're aiming for and the outcomes we're looking for. So essentially a post-it note exercise, people do it on their own, and then we stick them up, we align them, and we affinity map what people are looking at. And it's my job and the delivery manager's job just to check this out and make sure there wasn't any huge discrepancies between what we're looking for. And luckily there wasn't. People said things like to kickstart the native iOS development for Network Locum was our purpose, making sure we created a fantastic app that covered the booking flow from end to end. It was in the ballpark. We weren't thinking, people were saying we need to redesign the whole experience for people for Network Locum, which is great, that helps out. One of the things we didn't get around to in this kickoff was looking at roles. That's something we did separately with our team. But I want to talk about something that I did recently on this. This was a project during my time at Co-op Digital. And we looked at roles and responsibilities in a different way by creating a matrix of those roles and asking people to look at each person in their team at the start of the project and write down 5 bullet points on what they believe that person's role was and what they were here to do. So we weren't telling people what to do. We were asking people to, we weren't telling people to tell each other what they do. We were asking people to think about what each other does and then put that down. And then we could align and see where there was any discrepancies between that and see where we needed to change understanding of people's roles or work with that, and helped us get to a point where we could explore how people saw their roles. And that was super helpful. Our team principles are something that sometimes people see as a bit of a cliche on projects, but I think they're really, really important. For a 10-week project, we had to be really, really razor-sharp focused, and we had to make sure that we communicated early and often any issues that we felt like were coming along. We couldn't actually wait for people to say, 2 weeks later, they weren't sure about something. So we made it very clear that our focus was on open and honest feedback, for example. And our delivery managers, our agile coach, Alana, on that, made sure she planned her work to make sure that we were constantly working towards great communication. Especially important because we'd never worked in that configuration before as a team. And Tom was new, so we had to make sure we break down some walls there and plan some workshop activities along the way that allowed us to work on our communication and work on those difficult conversations. Basically, retrospective, things like that, we did them on a weekly basis. We made sure we set goals for each other. And we made sure we injected fun into the project and spent some time with each other off task. Okay, so we asked Network Locum to tell us about their users. We really needed to get information fast on this project. Normally, we'd want to go and find out and do some discovery around users before we move forward, perhaps. A couple of weeks, doing some interviews, that kind of thing. We still needed to do this on this project, but we wanted to know what we could move forward with as soon as possible. This is what they brought to us, and this was a great eye-opener, because when we spent some time in the kickoff understanding what we knew about users and the people who were going to be using this product, we realized that actually there was some work to be done here, because this didn't really paint a picture that we needed to understand Network Locum's users, which meant Paz started to work straight away on planning how he could use user research. We mandated to our stakeholders that we want to see people on a weekly basis. We're going to do user research and test our designs at the same time and move forward that way, because we need to understand behavior of these locum doctors, whereas at the moment, we have some very sketchy information about who users are. I tried to think about this a little bit more, so get some thoughts and assumptions in the project by using an empathy map and also a tool on Strategizer, which is looking at value proposition design. If you look at their value canvas, it gives you pains, gains, and needs, which is also a great way to capture this information, which is something we could then prioritize in our projects by looking at assumptions. So our assumptions, we had to transfer this information somewhere else because this was just not a big enough sheet in the end. But the idea of doing assumptions mapping at the end of a workshop helps you gain an understanding of priority, I guess, and what you think everyone in the room thinks. It gives that first alignment on prioritization. So some of the things that are really high priority on this is for Tom, he had to understand the technology as soon as possible. So that was his main piece of work. APIs were the things he needed to look at. He needed to understand how good they are, how well they're documented. And we needed to make sure we had someone on hand in Network Locum who could make changes on the fly for us. Users we covered, and from a product point of view, we really needed to put some shape around this product as soon as possible. We ended the session by just defining a product vision as quickly as possible. It's just something where we could put something in the ground and say what this is. And again, this is another alignment exercise. People doing this on their own and coming back and playing back to us. There's a whole workshop I would normally do about product visions, but it was worth doing just a half an hour session on this just to get an understanding on a 10-week project. And this generally was led by Melissa in terms of her view on what the project was and what the product was about. And it really helps. It's quite a narrow vision, let's be honest, but we weren't there to try and change the world. We were there to get this product into the market in 10 weeks. So this really helped focus our time and efforts, and having that vision statement really, really was important to us. Okay, so we finished the kickoff, but how did that help us? Well, it gave us everything we needed to start making. It helped us form a very loose product strategy based on assumptions, based on what we thought was the right approach, something we could continue to develop and iterate upon as we move forward in the project. And that was really important. It gave us all these pieces that we needed to start to build from. If we had to, we could just start to make an application then. It was based on shaky information, but we could take that forward and use our assumptions to build from. And over time, if we could try and verify some of that information, the application itself would become more robust and more focused on user needs. But I also think a great kickoff provides that rocket fuel to get towards being a highly effective team, to move out of that sort of dependency and inclusion area and count dependency in flight. A great kickoff gets you into that stage two as quickly as can, gets people thinking about the idea that they can actually challenge what we're saying rather than just agreeing with the loudest person in the room or the person they see as the leader. Gets us into that point where we're in stage three and four of group development and thinking about being highly effective as a team. And when we fell out of that, because we had already broke down some barriers, we were able to get back up into that highly effective team area in stages three and four quickly. On projects where we've not been able to do that, we've stayed in this area of one and two, and we've moved into fighting, we've disagreed with each other, and then we've fallen back down to compliance and just agreeing with each other, and we're in that sort of cocktail party mode where everything's great. Hi, how are you? What are you doing? Yeah, I'm fine. How are you? And we never really challenge each other and tell people that their breath smells, for example, or the clothes they're wearing, they don't like them, and the types of things you might tell your spouse or partner at home if you need to. So we need to get to that point where we have trust in our team and we can move towards work and productivity. And a great kickoff really does that. I also believe that a really great kickoff helps tap into our innate desire to want to do great things. We all work in an industry that is about creativity. Whether you see what you do as digital project managers as creative or not, it is. And everything we do from a digital point of view is a creative act. And we're working with people who are on different domains. We have different ways of working. We have designers and developers and testers and coders. And project managers and service designers and product managers, etc., all need to come together to be able to create something that then solves a problem. It meets some outcomes, generally for users. And to do that is a highly complex thing to do. To turn up to a kickoff, for example, with an Excel spreadsheet full of requirements and user stories isn't going to allow people to move forward with autonomy to try and solve a problem themselves. It's going to constrain them too far down into a point where they have no choice but to just build what's in front of them. It's all predefined. We have no time to understand the pieces of the puzzle and take that forward and form an opinion within the team what the principle of mission is. But I guess it also helps us understand purpose, which I guess from all of us in what we do, we want to make sure that the things we work on are important to us. We're going to make a difference and I'm going to improve my skills and master the thing that I want to be good at. And that, I think, is what a great kickoff brings to the table. And that's it from me. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Lawrence. Does anyone in the audience have questions? Yeah, Matt.
If I'm honest, we wrote it into the statement of work. So we said, if we take this on, we're going to require this access to users. And the client was actually probably one of the best clients I've worked with in terms of finding users. They paid a lot of money to their locum GPs, and they created an appointment in their product, which was about doing user testing in London, which people could sign up to. So we had a really nice mechanism for signing them up. So it's probably an outlier in terms of that case. We had a client who was willing to pay a substantial amount to their customers for being a participant, and they put the effort in. But the main reason is because we said we need people, and we're going to need people on maximum weekly basis. Thank you.
Anyone else? Sally.
Yeah. That's a great question. So in this talk, I don't want to focus on the day, the kickoff day itself. And you can see that I didn't talk about ways of working and mechanics of projects, which we had to cover on the fly on this project just because we didn't have enough time to spend 2 days on a kickoff, which might have been nice to do an inception day, which allowed us to do that. But the discovery on this particular project was 1 week, and that was an incredibly short amount of time we felt to do that. That's why we had to work very, very quickly. in terms of the communication and go our separate ways and come back every day and tell each other what they learned. And that meant the stand-up and talking after stand-ups was super important to that. But generally, I would like to spend a minimum of 2 weeks on a discovery phase for a new piece of work, especially if we're not sure about the user need that we're trying to fulfill and we need to understand the goals, the tasks, and the journeys that we're going to build a system around. I think one of the things that we did have from this is we had a web platform where we could assume a journey from and use that to take ourselves forward and then challenge that when we went and met with users.
Matt's got another question.
We were close enough to be in 15 minutes walking distance, and we had them over 3-4 times a week. We had made sure they were in workshops. Melissa did a great job, but I mean, she was the CEO of a company, of a small company. She spent most of the time in meetings on her phone, emailing people, which is when we had to say halfway through the project, this isn't working out for us, we need these decisions, we need you in the room. And we nominated Michael to be more of a product owner in that sense. But yes, we were essentially co-located, and we were working with, from their side, I guess underneath Michael was someone who was essentially, he was a catch-all developer who was working in a startup, but from a back-end point of view, he understood the API and wrote the API, but being a startup didn't have documentation that he could send us really easily. So we had to rely on that and cause issues within their development pipeline for their main platform, so they could provide us time and attention, which they were happy to do so. We had product owners who could prioritize really, really effectively as well.
All right. I think that's all the time we have. I'm PMing this event, and we're over time now. So thank you so much for a great presentation and for kicking us off. Cheers.